Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In today's session, we are going to discuss the type of neuronal cells present in the visual cortex. In our last session, we have discussed the detailed structural organization of the primary as well as the secondary visual cortex. And we have also discussed how the signals and the nerve fibers terminate and are processed in the visual cortex. Today, we are going to talk about the types of cells present in the visual cortex. After completing this topic, we will discuss the effect of lesions in the optic pathway, means which type of visual defects are going to be produced if there are lesions at different sites in the optic pathway. And finally, we are going to talk about the light reflex. So here we begin with the type of neuronal cells present in the visual cortex. There are three types of cells present in the visual cortex: simple cells, complex cells, and hypercomplex cells. Now, the simple cells in the visual cortex are the linearly organized and mutually inhibiting cells, which are responsible for detecting the direction of orientation of lines or borders in the visual fields. The orientation can be vertical, horizontal, or inclined. These are the simplest cells found in the visual cortex. The next cell type is complex cells. The complex cells receive the inputs from the simple cells, and these complex cells are present in the superficial layers of the visual cortex. In our last session, we discussed that when the visual signals terminate in the layer 4 of the visual cortex, further, the signals are processed to the superficial as well as the deep layer of the visual cortex. So the superficial layers of the visual cortex contain the complex cells, and they are further going to analyze the visual signals, and these are specially stimulated by preferred orientation of a stimulus, but these cells are not position specific. Which means even if the stimulus is slightly moved up or down or laterally in the visual field, the same set of complex cells will be stimulated. The third cell type present in the visual cortex is the hypercomplex cells. The hypercomplex cells are present in the higher visual processing areas, and these cells are stimulated by lines of specific lengths and specific angulated shapes. So they are responsible to detect the higher orders of information from the visual scene. So these are the three types of cells present in the visual cortex. Again, I am repeating: the simple cells, the complex cells, and the hypercomplex cells. Simple cells analyze the simple details. Complex and the hypercomplex cells detect more complex details of the visual images. Now we will move on to the lesions of the optic pathway. Before we discuss the specific lesions of the optic pathway and the visual field defects which they are going to produce, it is important to get familiar with certain terms which will be used while discussing the lesions. So the first term is anopia. Anopia means loss of vision and eye. An means no, and opia is related to vision. So loss of vision in one eye is known as anopia. Then there is another term which is used in visual fields defects is hemianopia. Hemi means half, and anopia again is loss of vision. So if there is loss of vision in half of the visual field of one eye, this is called as hemianopia. Again, I'm repeating that if there is loss of vision and half of the visual field of an eye, this is known as hemianopia. There is another term, homonymous. Homo means same. And if there is loss of vision in same halves of the both visual fields, the visual field defect is said to be homonymous. I'm repeating, if there is loss of vision in same halves of the both visual fields, this defect is known as homonymous. By same halves, we mean either the right half of the both visual fields or the left half of the both visual fields. Then the other term is heteronymous. Hetero mean different. So if there is loss of vision in opposite halves of the both visual fields, the visual field defect is said to be heteronymous. I'm again going to repeat it. Loss of vision in opposite halves of the both visual fields is known as heteronymous visual defect. It means that one eye has loss of vision in the right half, while the other eye is going to have loss of vision in the left half. So opposite halves of the both visual fields are affected. So this is known as heteronymous. This diagram shows you different visual field defects which are produced by the lesion at different sites in the visual pathway. So we are going to begin it with the lesion of optic nerve. So here it is. This is the optic nerve of the right side. So if there is lesion of the right optic nerve, if there is lesion of right optic nerve, it is going to cause anopia on the right side, means loss of vision completely in the right eye, blindness in the right eye. It will be produced by the lesion of the right optic nerve. And if there is a lesion of the left optic nerve, it will cause blindness in the left eye. Now this lesion can be produced by injury to the optic nerve. So the cause of lesion can be the injury, or it can be compressed by a surrounding structure or by a tumor. So this will produce blindness in the site where the optic nerve is damaged. Second site of lesion is the optic chiasm. If there is lesion of the optic chiasm affecting its center, it is going to produce a heteronymous defect. It means that both eyes are going to be affected, means there will be loss of vision in half of the both visual fields, and these halves will be opposite. On one side it will be the right half, and on the other side it is the left half. So this is called as heteronymous defect, since it is due to damage to the nasal fibers, because in the center of optic chiasm we know that nasal fibers of both eyes are present. So damage to the nasal fibers of the both side in the center of optic chiasm is going to produce bitemporal heteronymous hemianopia. Why did we say bitemporal? Because temporal halves of the both visual fields are defective. There is loss of vision in the temporal half of the both visual fields, and in terms of the right and left, one is the right half and the other is the left half. So damage to the nasal fibers in the center of optic chiasm is going to produce bitemporal heteronymous hemianopia. Now the lesion of the nasal fibers in the center of the optic chiasm, it can be caused by the pituitary tumors, which can cause compression of these fibers and atrophy of these fibers, leading to this visual field defect, which is heteronymous bitemporal hemianopia. If there is a lesion to the outer fibers of the optic chiasm, now look at this diagram, this point C, this shows lesion of the outer fibers of the optic chiasm on one side. And here we know the ipsilateral temporal fibers are present. So if there is damage to the temporal fibers in the outer part of the optic chiasm, this is going to produce nasal hemianopia, because the temporal fibers carry the visual signals from the nasal part of the visual field. So nasal hemianopia will be produced if there is damage to the temporal fibers on one side. This can be caused by the aneurysms of the internal carotid artery. If there is a bilateral aneurysm of the internal carotid artery, This will produce a bilateral visual field defect, which in this case would be binasal heteronymous hemianopia. In this figure, unilateral defect is being shown only, but if there are bilateral aneurysms of the both internal carotid arteries, it can cause a bilateral defect or damage to the temporal fibers and will produce binasal heteronymous hemianopia. Coming back to the previous slide, now if there is damage to the optic radiation, first we did the optic nerve, then we did the lesions at the optic chiasm and the visual field defects which can be produced, and then now we move to the lesions of the optic radiation, the optic tract. If there is damage to the optic tract, it will produce a homonymous defect. Damage to the optic tract, this is it, will produce a homonymous defect. Now why homonymous? Because optic tract carries the fibers from both eyes. It has ipsilateral temporal fibers and contralateral nasal fibers. So it will produce either the right-sided or the left-sided homonymous hemianopia. I'm repeating that the lesion of optic tract will produce bilateral defect, which will be homonymous right-sided or homonymous left-sided hemianopia. If there is damage to the right optic tract, it will produce left-sided homonymous hemianopia, which means left half of the both visual fields will be defective. There will be loss of vision in the left half of the both visual fields. Now, the lesions of the optic radiation, it also produce homonymous hemianopia, which is the same as is produced by the lesion of the optic tract. There is another phenomena which is associated with the lesions of the optic radiation as well as with the lesion of the visual cortex. This phenomena is known as macular sparing. In this diagram labeled as G, you can see a white spot in the blind area. This white spot shows the preservation of vision, which is the central vision or the macular vision. So this preservation of vision in the lesions of optic radiation or the visual cortex is known as macular sparing. Now the question is, why is there macular sparing? Yet the exact cause of macular sparing is not known, but there are different mechanisms which are proposed for this phenomena. The first reason for macular sparing is that macular area and the macular fibers are relatively larger, so there are not usually the very extensive lesion which can destroy the macular fibers or the macular area completely. So there will be a partial lesion, so macula will be spared. Second reason for macular sparing is that the area of the macula in the visual cortex, it receives dual blood supply. It receives blood supply from the middle as well as the posterior cerebral artery. So if one artery is blocked, the other artery will continue to supply the blood and macula will be preserved. And third and the last cause for the macular sparing is that macular fibers are represented bilaterally. Now what does bilateral representation means? It means that macula from both eyes, or we can say the macular fibers of the both eyes, terminate in the visual cortices on the both sides. So even if there is damage to one visual cortex or optic radiation on the one side, the macular fibers in the opposite tract will still continue to transmit the signals and there will be preservation of some form of macular vision. This we have already discussed, that the lesion of the visual cortex will produce the same defect as is produced by the lesion of the optic radiation. Now, what is the effect of the lesion in the visual cortex? This is very interesting. It produces cortical blindness. It does not mean that the person is blind and is not able to see, but it means that subject can see, because appreciation of vision or image is the function of the primary visual cortex. So the person is not blind, he or she is able to see, but he cannot recognize or give meaning to what he sees. And this also emphasizes the functions of the secondary visual cortex that we have already discussed in our previous session, that secondary visual cortex is concerned with the analysis of the different aspects of the visual signals, like recognizing the form, 3D position in space, and the colors and the other details of the fine images. So if there is damage to the visual secondary visual cortex, blindness is not produced, but ability to recognize or to give meaning to what is seen is lost, and this particular form of visual field defect is known as cortical blindness. In the last session, we also talked about some non-visual fibers in the optic nerve. Today, we are going to talk about those non-visual fibers as well. These constitute about 10% of the total fibers present in the optic pathway. These fibers do not terminate in the primary visual cortex. Instead, the non-visual fibers in the optic nerve go to the other areas of the brain. And in this regard, four areas of the brain are important. The first one is the suprachiasmatic nucleus, which is present in the hypothalamus. Now, those fibers which terminate in the suprachiasmatic nucleus of the hypothalamus are concerned with control of circadian rhythm. The fibers from the optic pathway also terminate in the pretactal nucleus, and these fibers are concerned with the reflex movements of eyes in response to visual stimulation, and they are also responsible for control of light reflex. Then the third area of the brain where fibers terminate is the superior colliculi. Now, fibers terminating in the superior colliculus are responsible for rapid directional movements of the eyes, obviously in response to certain visual stimulus. And the fourth area is the ventral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. Ventral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. Now, these fibers, they help to control body's behavioral responses to different visual stimuli. So I'm repeating, there are four important areas where non-visual fibers are going to terminate from the optic pathway. The first one being the suprachiasmatic nucleus for control of circadian rhythm. Second one, pretectal nucleus for the reflex movement of the eyes and elicitation of the light reflex. Third area is the superior colliculus for rapid directional movement of the eyes. And the fourth area is the ventral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus to help control the body response to different visual stimuli. Now, this diagram shows the termination of the fibers from the optic pathways to the areas other than visual cortex. Here we can see some fibers from the optic pathway leave it and terminate in the pretactal nucleus, while some of the fibers leave the optic pathway and terminate in the superior colliculus. And here we can see the fibers of the optic pathway leaving the tract and terminating in the suprachiasmatic nucleus of the hypothalamus. Now, the next topic is light reflex. Now, light reflex is a constriction of the pupil which occurs reflexly when the light is thrown into an eye. So this is the definition. It is the reflex constriction of the pupil when the light is thrown into the eyes. Now, degree of pupillary constriction in response to light, it depends upon the amount or the intensity of the light. Greater the intensity of light, greater will be the degree of pupillary constriction. Now, light into an eye, it produces a direct and indirect response. Direct response or direct right reflex is the constriction of pupil in the eye which is being stimulated, means the eye into which the light is thrown. While indirect response or the indirect light reflex is constriction of pupil in the eye which is not stimulated, or we can say constriction of the pupil in the other eye where the into which the light is not thrown, is known as indirect light reflex or indirect response of the pupil to the light. Now, whether the direct or the indirect response, there are two important functions performed by the light reflex. One is that it controls the amount of light entering the eye. And secondly, by controlling the amount of light entering the eye, it reduces the spherical and chromatic aberrations, and reduction in spherical and chromatic aberration enhances the visual acuity. Now, this diagram shows you the pupillary constriction. Here in the center, this is the pupil. So these are the circular muscle fibers in the iris, and these are the dilator muscles present in the iris. So when there is contraction of the circular muscle fibers, this will produce pupillary constriction. And these fibers, we already know, are innervated by the parasympathetic fibers, which are present in the oculomotor nerve. And through the oculomotor nerve, they first reach the ciliary ganglion. And from the ciliary ganglion, through the short ciliary nerves, these muscle fibers are innervated. Now, this is the light reflex, both the direct and the indirect response of the eyes to the light. So when you shine light into an eye, it causes the signals to be transmitted through the optic pathway to the pretectal nucleus. This is it, okay, which is present in the midbrain. Optic pathway transmit the signals to the pretectal nucleus. And from the pretectum, signals are transmitted to the Edinger Westphal nuclei on the both sides. Of the same side which is being stimulated and of the other side which is not stimulated. Now, this transmission of the signals from the pretectum to the opposite Edinger Westphal nucleus is basically responsible for a bilateral response or a bilateral pupillary constriction. So from the Edinger Westphal nucleus on the both sides, the signal is transmitted through the oculomotor nerve. These are the parasympathetic fibers present in the oculomotor nerve. These fibers terminate in the ciliary ganglion. In the ciliary ganglion, the postganglionic fibers are the short ciliary nerves which innervate the constrictor pupillae, and stimulation of these fibers will result in pupillary constriction on the both sides. This is the direct response and this is the indirect response. Now, this flowchart shows you the pathway of the direct light reflex and the indirect light reflex. Indirect light reflex is also known as consensual light reflex. So, when you throw light into left eye, left optic pathway is carrying this information, carrying these signals to the pretectal nucleus. And from the left pretectal nucleus, the signal will be transmitted to both Edinger Westphal nucleus on the left side as well as on the right side. On the left side, it will produce a direct light reflex, the pathway we have already discussed in the previous slide. And on the other side, it will produce an indirect light reflex or the consensual light reflex. And cause of consensual light reflex, again, I'm repeating that the cause is that from the pretectum, signals are passed to the Edinger Westphal nuclei of the both sides. Next is Horner syndrome. Now, Horner syndrome is an abnormality of the pupillary light reflex. It is caused by damage to the cervical sympathetic chain, which supplies the sympathetic fibers to different areas of the face. Like, sympathetic fibers innervate the muscles present in the upper eyelid, These sympathetic fibers also innervate the dilator pupillary muscle, and these also innervate the blood vessels present on that side and the sweat glands. So if there is damage to the cervical sympathetic chain, this will result in characteristic features which include the drooping of eyelid, which is known as ptosis. This is because of damage to the sympathetic fibers which are supplying the smooth muscles present in the upper eyelid. Then there is miosis. Miosis is because of the damage to the sympathetic fibers that innervate the dilator pupillary muscle. So if there is damage to the sympathetic fibers which innervate the dilator muscles, the constrictor muscle become, or the constrictor tone becomes more prominent, and there is pupillary constriction. And damage to the fibers which innervate the blood vessels will produce vasodilation, increased blood flow and flushing of face. And damage to the sympathetic fibers that innervate the sweat glands will produce anhydrosis. So these characteristic features together are known as Horner syndrome, caused by damage to the cervical sympathetic chain. Next is ciliospinal reflex. Ciliospinal reflex is produced by a painful pinching in the neck. This causes the stimulation of cervical sympathetic fibers, and this results in pupillary dilation. So pupillary dilation in response to a painful stimulus in the neck is called as ciliospinal reflex, and this is mediated by cervical sympathetic fibers. Next abnormal condition is Argyle-Robertson pupil. It's a condition in which pupillary reaction to light is lost. However, when the patient is asked to accommodate for close vision, pupil will show constriction. Such a pupil which does not respond to light but it shows constriction during accommodation, such a pupil is known as Argyle-Robertson pupil. The lack of response during when the light is thrown into the eye is because of damage to the pretectum and in the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, which causes a damage to the reflex arc, and there is loss of light reflex. But in case of accommodation, there is pupillary constriction, and this is because of the fact that during accommodation, the Edinger-Westphal nucleus is stimulated through a separate pathway. In this case, the signals come from the frontal eye field directly to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. So this Edinger-Westphal nucleus is stimulated, and the signals are transmitted from the Edinger-Westphal nucleus to the constrictor pupillary muscle, and it will show pupillary constriction. The cause of Argyle-Robertson pupil include the central nervous system syphilis, alcoholism, encephalitis, and all these causes are going to produce lesion in the pretectum and in the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, which will result in loss of light reflex. I again emphasize that there is loss of light reflex, means response to light is lost, but when the pupil is stimulated through another pathway, such as during accommodation, it will show constriction. Such a condition is known as Argyle-Robertson pupil. Now here is a list of different conditions which can cause pupillary constriction, and these include the light. Greater the light, greater will be the degree of pupillary constriction. Then pupils also show constriction during near response, which is accommodation. The pupillary constriction also occurs in Horner syndrome, and the cause and mechanism we have discussed in detail. Similarly, in Argyle-Robertson pupil, in addition to the loss of light reflex, the pupils also remain permanently constricted. They become of smaller size. Then in pontine hemorrhage, there is pupillary constriction, and pupillary constriction also occurs in morphine poisoning. Now this slide shows you a list of the causes that can or list of the conditions that result in pupillary dilation. So first one is dim light. Dim light will produce pupillary dilation. In ciliospinal reflex, there is pupillary dilation. We just discussed that this is painful stimulus application in the neck will produce pupillary dilation. Then sympathetic stimulation during fight and flight condition also produce pupillary dilation. Use of anticholinergic drugs like atropine produce pupillary constriction. And if there is damage to the third cranial nerve, again there will be pupillary dilation, because in the third cranial nerve parasympathetic fibers are present that innervate the constrictor pupillae, and if these fibers are paralyzed, pupils will be dilated. And finally, and the last cause of pupillary dilation is the death. In death, the pupils are fixed, permanently dilated. Thank you.